Brother Michael Hatcher is our speaker. He has quite a lengthy write-up here. I will not try to go down through all of it. I think you were the only one that requested that, Doug. He was born November 27, 1952, in Pensacola, Florida, to William C. Bill and Peggy Hatcher. And he was a gospel preacher who passed away in 1986. He was brought up in Garland, Texas, Lubbock, Texas, West Palm Beach, Florida. Married to the former Karen S. Savage of Trenton, Texas, on August 4th, 1978. They have two sons, William Andrew and Daniel Michael. He served a number of congregations in Florida, Texas, Oklahoma, and Arkansas. He's the editor of The Defender, director of the annual Bellevue Lectureship, editor of their bulletin, The Beacon, and has worked in a number of different positions and done a good job in all of them. We appreciate him and his work for the Lord. We count him as a near and dear friend. Wish him the best, along with Karen, and wish for her great long suffering. Come and speak to us. Fatal era of present day Holy Spirit baptism.
It's a joy to be here, as it is every year. This has been a great lectureship throughout the years, and look forward to its continuation to be a great lectureship. Appreciate the elders, appreciate David, and most of that introduction. Present-day Holy Spirit baptism. For years, the church has faced the problem that the Pentecostals in their position and promotion of the present-day Holy Spirit baptism. We met them on polemic platform, defeated their doctrines. But sadly, those doctrines are now and have made their way into the Lord's church. And while most of those in the Lord's church today who accept present-day Holy Spirit baptism don't advocate miracles, brethren, it's coming. That is the next logical step. And thus, it is important for us to understand the subject. I will encourage you to buy the book, read the chapters, because I'm not going to get to all the material that's in the book, as most of the speakers don't get to all of the material. So, buy the book. It will be well worth it. But John's promise in Matthew, the third chapter, in verse 11, that I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. This is the first time we are introduced to Holy Spirit baptism. Now, Joel had mentioned the pouring out of the Spirit in Joel 2. Holy Spirit baptism is a part of that pouring out of the Spirit. Pouring out of the Spirit embraces more than just the baptism of the Holy Spirit, though. But in this context of Matthew 3, we find three baptisms that are being mentioned. A lot of people only want to limit it to two: Holy Spirit baptism and baptism of fire. But there's also John's baptism, which is baptism in water unto repentance for the remission of sins. We see in Mark 1 and verse 4. The baptism of fire, within context, if you look at verse 10 and verse 12, is eternal punishment. Thus, many individuals who want to advocate present-day Holy Spirit baptism ignore John's baptism of water. And they often appeal to this word, you. He shall baptize you with in the Holy Spirit and in fire. And they try to make that a universal you. There's a quote from Brother Roy Deaver in the book that I would encourage you to read, dealing with this, in which he shows that instead of that being a universal you, everyone is baptized in the Holy Spirit or baptized in fire, it in reality is some of you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit, some of you will be baptized in fire, some of you will be baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sins. As to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, though, we have to look to further revelation as to who it is that is going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And so when we start doing that, we come to John the 14th, 15th, and 16th chapters. And Jesus is meeting here with his apostles. And in chapter 14, verses 15 through 17, he promises them another comforter, which is going to be the Holy Spirit, that he is going to be sent from the Father to them. Now then, to take things that are recorded and spoken to his apostles and make them applicable to other people does an injustice to the Scriptures. We immediately recognize that if you talk about God told Noah to go build an ark. How many of us are ready to go build an ark? Maybe a couple of you might have been wanting to a couple of nights ago, but with the storms that came. But we recognize that's not for us. Well, why can't we recognize that when Jesus speaks to his apostles, it applies to them, not us? But he tells them in this context, in chapter 16, verses 7 through verse 15, what the Spirit's work is going to be. It is going to be to reprove the world or to convict the world. And there's three areas in which he's going to convict or reprove the world: of sin, of righteousness, and judgment. Now there's the work of the Spirit in relationship to man. Jesus also reveals to the apostles on this occasion how the Spirit is going to accomplish his work. In chapter 14 and verse 26, he says, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." Skip over to chapter 15 and verse 26, "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me." And then in chapter 16 and verse 13, he says, "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come." Now, when we add these passages together, these three verses, we see that the Holy Spirit would be sent to the apostles, not anyone else. He is saying, you, the apostles, the Holy Spirit's going to come to you. This is what he's going to do. He's going to guide them into all truth. He's going to show them things to come. And he's going to bring to their remembrance all that Jesus had said unto them. Now that's how he is going to accomplish his work of reproving the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Now then, when we read these chapters and Jesus' conference with these apostles, we start seeing who those some of you of Matthew 3 and verse 11 really are. That it's going to be the apostles that the Holy Spirit is going to come unto. But as we continue on in our study of the Scriptures, of course, Jesus dies, he's buried, he's raised again, and then he begins appearing to his apostles. And in John the 20th chapter, verse 21 through verse 23, Jesus says unto them, "Peace unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said, Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto you, and unto them, and whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. Here he is imparting to them, you receive the Holy Ghost. Notice that he is doing this to the apostles, not us today, but to the apostles. You receive the Spirit. When we turn back to Luke, the 24th chapter then, and verses 46 and following, what we generally refer to as Luke's account of the Great Commission, tells him, Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. We'll come back to that aspect, beginning at Jerusalem, in just a moment. But then he goes on, And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father unto you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Now again, Jesus here is speaking to the apostles, not to anyone else, but to them. And he tells them, you are going to be witnesses. While it's another lesson, let me just mention, no one today is a witness of Christ. No one meets the qualifications. You can't be one. But the apostles were. And he's saying, you're going to be my witnesses. As witnesses, the Father, or Jesus, would send the promise of the Father to the apostles. Again, not anyone today. The apostles were told, you wait in Jerusalem till you be endued or clothed with power from on high, power from God. Now then, when we start seeing the promise of the Father and the power from on high, these two aspects are connected. You cannot have one without the other. That's why those who are advocating for Holy Spirit baptism today will eventually go to miraculous. They can't help themselves. Because Jesus here connects this promise of the Father and the power from on high. Turn over to Acts, the first chapter. In verses 4 and verse 5, it says that here's Jesus being assembled together with, and it's the apostles again, with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. That's not us today. That's the apostles that he's talking to. But wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Skip down to verse 8. But ye shall receive power. After that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in all Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Now he's assembled with his apostles. He commands them to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. He identifies now the promise of the Father as being the baptism of the Holy Spirit that John had spoken of. And thus we now know that that promise of the Father, it is Holy Spirit baptism that we read in Luke 24, verse 49. And now then Jesus is tied inseparably Holy Spirit baptism to receiving the power. And that's in, again, verse 8. You're going to receive power. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is coming upon you. And thus you're receiving power. The apostles, not anyone else, would receive this power when the Spirit came upon them. Now then, the apostles receiving this power is connected with the Holy Spirit coming upon the apostles. You cannot have one without the other. They are inseparable. If you have the power, you have the Holy Spirit baptism. If you have Holy Spirit baptism, you have the power. You cannot separate the two. both of these, Holy Spirit baptism, the promise of the Father, the receiving of power from on high, all of those are connected to, verse 8, there being a witness. Now then, the apostles and the apostles only are the witnesses. And in the book, there's more detail about that, but study Acts, the latter part of Acts 1 and Acts 10th chapter, and you see that is a specific term used for the apostles and the apostles only. Thus, we again learn who is going to receive Holy Spirit baptism. It's the apostles and only the apostles. That's the only ones that it was promised to. But how do we know that's right? Well, Jesus said, wait in Jerusalem until you receive this. So the logical thing is, go to Jerusalem. And let's see who received this power, the Holy Spirit baptism. The apostles were promised it. Wasn't promised to anyone else. But when we see that who receives it, we can then confirm that what we have been stating is right. In Jerusalem, thus, in chapter 2 of Acts, and verse 1, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. The Holy Spirit then, in verses 2 through 4, comes upon the they of verse 1. So whoever the they are of verse 1 are the ones who received Holy Spirit baptism. The question is, who are the they? Does it include us today? Obviously not. Those teaching present-day Holy Spirit baptism want to try to make the they of chapter 2 and verse 1 refer back to chapter 1 and verse 15 and the 120 that were there. But very simply, grammatically, it does not fit. They is a pronoun. It has to refer back to an antecedent that agrees with it in number. But it would not go back to the 120. Instead, it goes back to the apostles. Now, then, just follow the context of Acts, the first chapter. There in verse 15, yes, you have that 120 being discussed. But in verses 16 through 20, Peter is then speaking about the death of Judas. And then in verse 20, you have the need for someone to replace Judas. And so verses 21 through 23, two individuals are put forward. After prayer, the Lord chooses Matthias, verses 24 through 26. And he was numbered with the 11 apostles. And then chapter 2 and verse 1, very next verse, they who? The apostles. That's the whole context. That's the grammar. But someone complains, well, grammar's all you got. Well, brethren, that's all we need. Don't need anything else. But do we have anything else? Yes, we do. We don't have to rely just upon grammar. The rest of Acts 2 confirms this. Now notice, you have the gathering of the crowd together. And the people there at Jerusalem began hearing them speak in various languages of men, leading to the question, stating, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And they were amazed. That's chapter 2 and verse 7. We know, chapter 1 and verse 11, that all of the apostles were Galileans. It would be highly unlikely that all the 120 were. But the scriptures specifically state that the apostles were. But then, in chapter 2 and verse 12 through 14, Peter stands up with the 120. Well, not quite. There's a few short of 120. Peter stood up with the 11 and began speaking. Why just the 11? Why not the 120? Because the 120 didn't receive that power. They didn't receive the Holy Spirit baptism. Skip down to verse 32 of chapter 2. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof, now notice this, we all are witnesses. Who's the witnesses? It's the apostles. Who's the we? The ones who received Holy Spirit baptism. The ones who are speaking. Thus we know that it's only the apostles who received the Holy Spirit baptism. Look at verse 33. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has shed forth this which ye now see and hear. Received of the Father and the promise of the Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost. Go back to the promise that was made to the apostles in Luke 24, verse 48 and 49, and Acts 1, verses 4 and 5 that we read. The apostles again. In verse 37, after hearing this, the Jews, that says they were pricked in their hearts, and they said unto Peter and the 120, men and brethren, what shall we do? Now that's the way it should read if the 120 were baptized in the Holy Spirit. But it doesn't read that way, as you obviously know. They asked Peter and the rest of the apostles. Why only the apostles? Because only the apostles were baptized with the Holy Spirit. That's why. Not the 120. And thus, we now have confirmation that what we have explained from John 14 and Matthew 3 and these other passages refers only to the Holy Spirit baptism to the apostles, no one else. But in discussing this, we also need to see the design or the purpose of Holy Spirit baptism. And there are two reasons that I want to center upon. One is to effect revelation. In this conference that we have in John 14, 15, and 16 of Jesus with the apostles, we read chapter 14, verse 26, how that the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. And in chapter 16 and verse 13, that when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but he will that, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. These two passages is citing what the Spirit would do for the apostles to carry out the Spirit's work of reproving the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. But in that, it shows that he would teach the apostles all things. That's in chapter 14, verse 26. He would bring to the apostles' remembrance all that Jesus said. Again, chapter 14, verse 26. He would guide them into all truth, chapter 16 and verse 13. He would show them things to come, again, chapter 16 and verse 13. And so we have four things that are stated here. But all four things concern revelation, the revelation of God's will. In teaching them all things, those individuals who believe that these passages apply to us today, well, they have all truth. They don't need anyone to teach them anything. No wonder they can be so arrogant. But all four of these things deal with the revelation of God's will to man. And they are all necessary for the inerrant, infallibly recording of God's message. If they don't have these things, then why can't their writings be fallible? They would be. But by the Spirit's guiding them into all things, teaching them all things, bringing to their remembrance all that Jesus said, guiding them into all truth, showing them things to come, their message to man is infallible. If Holy Spirit baptism is for us today, those who then have that Holy Spirit baptism will be speaking infallibly. Sad to say, they make a lot of mistakes, though. Again, it would be improper to take what is stated here to the apostles and apply them to all men or all Christians. Christianity, by its very nature, is a teaching religion. If these things apply to Christians today, there is absolutely no reason to be teaching anyone anything. A lectureship such as this with you brethren here would be absolutely a waste of our time, because you already know all things. The Spirit's guiding you into all things. He's guiding you into all truth. You know everything that Jesus said already. You know about the things that are going to come. There's no need for a lectureship like this if we're baptized with the Holy Spirit. There's no reason for us to edify and build up one another, because we have all of these things directly from the Spirit if we are baptized in the Holy Spirit today. But obviously, we don't have all those things. I want to see that individual start pronouncing all of those names starting in 1 Chronicles 1. Now, of course, they're not going to need a Bible to do it, because they have all truth, and I want to learn how to pronounce some of those names. Maybe you already know all of them. I don't. And I can look at them and still sounds like a horribly messed up. Well, they don't have that ability because they are not baptized with the Holy Spirit. That's one of the fatal errors of Holy Spirit baptism today. But then, not only for revelation, but confirmation. We see this in Mark 16, verses 19 and 20. That after the Lord had spoken unto them, the apostles specifically, he was received up into heaven and set on the right hand of God. And they, the apostles, went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. The apostles went out preaching. When they did that, how would that hearer know whether their message was from God or not? They couldn't say, turn over to Mark 16, 16, and we'll see that baptism conjoined with belief is going to equal salvation. Turn over to Acts 2 and verse 38, that he that believeth, well, I start quoting Mark 16 again. Repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Or turn over to Acts 22 and verse 16. The baptism will wash away our sins, and that's the way in which we call upon the name of the Lord. And so how will they know that that's the truth or not? They didn't have the scriptures in order to turn over to those passages. They go and tell someone that, and well, how do I know that that's true or not? They had miracles. And when they performed a miracle, that miracle said, this person's from God, and the message that he is giving is from God. Remember, Nicodemus comes to Jesus and says, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. Why? Because no one can do the miracles that you're doing except God be with him. Now then, when they performed the miracle, the individuals who are hearing them knew that the message was from God. It was confirming their word. We see the same thing in Hebrews 2, verse 3 and verse 4. that how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also bearing witness, both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. Here's the word of salvation. There's been a little bit of discussion about fatal error. Fatal error is error that causes one to lose their salvation. It causes one to be damned. That's fatal error. Now then, here's the word of salvation. That word that will cause us to be saved, to be able to spend eternity with God in heaven, as that beautiful song that we sang just a moment ago, heaven will be worth it all. It was first spoken by Christ, and you can go back to that great commission, and you can see how that Jesus then gave the words of he that believeth, the need for repentance, the need for baptism in order to be saved or to be made a disciple and to come into that relationship with deity. That's a combination of Matthew 28:19-20, Mark 16, and Luke 24:46-47. It was first spoken by Christ. Then the apostles, that's them that heard him, they also went out preaching that same word, that same message of salvation. And God confirmed the spoken word by the miracles that they performed. And so, here's confirmation of the Spirit by the miracles and that word which they are speaking. That word which we can go back to, John 16, was to reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and judgment. Now then, we have confirmation. The apostles, by virtue of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, had the power then to pass miraculous working ability, and that goes back now to Joel's prophecy of the pouring out of the Spirit upon all flesh. And that's all representative flesh. I don't think you can find anyone who believes that it is all flesh. Believe that it happened to animals. They have flesh. Oh, well, it's all human flesh. So you do believe it's representative. But do you believe that it's all human flesh? What about atheists, agnostics, skeptics, God haters, and on you? Well, of course not. So you do believe it's representative. Had one person, after going through that, said, no, it's all flesh, it's everybody, it's universal. Went through it again. He agreed every step. So you do believe that it's no, it's universal. About that time you give up. You start seeing, though, here's this pouring out of the Spirit. What? The apostle is able to pass miraculous working ability on to others by the laying on of their hands. And thus, as they go out preaching that message, they could confirm the word because they had miraculous working ability. Since there is no revelation today, there is no need for Holy Spirit baptism or miraculous powers today. If we have Holy Spirit baptism today, then we do have revelation today, because that is one of the two purposes of Holy Spirit baptism: revelation and confirmation. And so if you have Holy Spirit baptism, you have those things. Now then, you want to see again fatal error of Holy Spirit baptism today? They have to have additional revelation. They also have to have miracles in order to confirm that revelation. If they don't have new revelation, if they cannot confirm that word, then there is no Holy Spirit baptism today. That's why I would say at the very beginning, these individuals who are teaching Holy Spirit baptism today, they will eventually go off into miraculous powers today, because you can't have one without the other. In Ephesians, the 4th chapter, in verse 5, we have Paul writing in the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace that there is one baptism. Of course, those who advocate the Pentecostals, in particular Holy Spirit baptism, they want to make this one baptism Spirit baptism. Our brethren, some of them at least, who believe in Holy Spirit baptism are wanting to combine water baptism and Holy Spirit baptism and say it's one baptism. Even though you have two baptisms, they say it's one. We obviously know it's still two. What is this one baptism, though? There are several baptisms mentioned in the scriptures. In fact, there's a baptism of fire. There's Moses' baptism, there's others as well. What is the one baptism that is now in effect when Paul writes this to the Ephesian brethren? Well, notice that Paul writes, this is one of his prison epistles. He was in Rome in prison from 60 to 62, those approximate dates. And at that time, 60 to 62, he says there's one baptism. Now then, spirit baptism was never related to salvation. It was never a condition of salvation, nor was it ever evidence of salvation. It had nothing to do with salvation. When you get with water baptism, though, it is related to salvation, 1 Peter 3 and verse 20 and 21. It is a condition of salvation, Mark 16 and verse 16. It has everything to do with salvation. That should tell us enough all by itself that the one baptism of Ephesians 4 is water baptism. But when we turn over to 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter, and verse 20 and 21, we start seeing a little bit more. Because Peter here is going to deal with baptism. But what baptism is it? Well, that's found in verse 20 when he says, here's God's patience during the days of Noah, while Noah was preparing the ark, wherein 8 souls were, now notice it's saved by water. What's he talking about? Water salvation. Then he says, the like figure. What's the figure? Water salvation is the figure. Are we saved by water? That's what Peter is saying. That's the figure. Noah and his family were saved by water. We are saved by baptism. What is that baptism? It's water baptism. It's water salvation. Now then, the fact is that Peter wrote his book generally dated around AD 65. Now then, go back. Paul writes to the Ephesians when? 60 to 62. And he says there is one baptism. Now then, after Paul writes that, Peter talks about water baptism in 65. Since 1 Peter was written after the book of Ephesians, we know that the one baptism in Ephesians has to be water baptism, not spirit baptism. There's more material in the book dealing with it. John 3 and also 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 13. These are passages that are oftentimes used in relationship to Holy Spirit baptism today, but we don't have time to cover them. And so I want to express appreciation for your kind attention. Did I give some time back? A minute 58. I'll take it next time.
That works real well.
We don't have ecclesiastical conferences meeting to determine what goes on around here, especially the caliber of ecclesiastics. Well, well, in spite of all of that, that was a good sermon. We appreciate that so very much. The baptism that we preach is the baptism Jesus says be preached to the end of the world, and that was water baptism for the remission of sins, or else the Ethiopian eunuch got it all messed up. For some reason, as soon as water was deep enough to bury men, he said, "See, here's water, what did they have me baptized?" So all we have to do is stay with the truth we've known all along and not let people pull us away from it. And that's a challenge maybe within itself, but nevertheless, that's what Brother Bill Jackson used to talk about, being stubborn with the truth. And being steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord sounds rather stubborn to me. You just don't quit. You just keep on keeping on when you know you're right. I heard Brother Franklin Camp say, probably about 1972, that these liberals, as he spoke of them over 40 years ago, are out to make of us a sectarian, denominational, Holy Spirit, Pentecostal group. And I don't think I've ever heard an uninspired man's prophecy come true as much as that one has. Well, we thank you again, Michael, for that good lesson. We'll stand adjourned till 8 o'clock. It's about 10 till now, and then we'll assemble back to